So it's hello again to Miss Ayn Rand. We were coming to question number two from a gentleman who put question number one. Yes.
Yes, Miss Rand, question number two. What can the United States do to bring full equality for the American Negro? I mean by full equality, equal housing, equal jobs, equal social status, equal individual rights, and just plain decent treatment without completely changing our free enterprise system or radically upsetting our entire economic system.
Well, now look,
yes.
There is no reason why anybody should have equal housing with everybody else. You're now talking about an economic issue. There certainly is inequality of housing, inequality of income among men of all races, certainly among white men. Therefore, there is no reason why the Negroes or any other minority should be guaranteed housing. The only thing you can properly discuss is racial prejudice. That is, that Negroes should not be treated improperly or be treated with prejudice because of their color or their race. The only issue here is to treat every individual man as a human being and judge him according to his own actions, his own character, and his own performance. Therefore, all that you can discuss properly is to guarantee Negroes individual political rights, and that the government can do by not passing any or permitting any legislation which discriminates against the Negro legally. But now if you speak about private prejudice, racial prejudice, that cannot be achieved or eliminated by law. In order to eliminate private discrimination, you should advocate individual rights and the philosophy that goes with it. I will refer you to my article entitled Racism in my book, The Virtue of Selfishness, in which I discuss the fact that racism is just the lowest, most primitive form of collectivism. And in any period of history when collectivism is on the rise, men are forced to cling to one another, into groups, to seek groups, because a collectivist society or a mixed economy like we have today is a society of group warfare, pressure group warfare. And the easiest collective to join, particularly of men of not great intelligence, is race. Therefore, racism, the prejudice of racial groups against one another, is a byproduct of collectivism. It is the spread of collectivism that spreads racial prejudice. Why? Because men are taught that the individual has no rights, has no meaning, no significance outside of his group. Only groups count. That is the essence of collectivism. And consequently, racism is on the rise. The only way to abolish racism, private racism, is by advocating individualism and its corollary, a free society. In a free society, the white man's own rational self-interest would abolish racism, and those who are irrational, those who insist on running their business or their lives by racial prejudice, would be their only victims or their own victims. They should be boycotted by rational men, and they should be ostracized. That is, those who are not racist should refuse to deal with those who are guilty of racial prejudice. But you cannot forbid prejudice by law. A racist has a right not to associate with other people if he doesn't want to, just as a communist has a right to preach his ideas, to have his freedom of speech, even though his ideas are evil. In a free society, neither the communist nor the racist would be of much danger to anyone, and would gradually be eliminated by people's enlightenment and by people's rational self-interest.
Thank you very much, Bill Colson.
Miss Rand, I want to thank you very much. And in the last 2 minutes, I really say this sincerely, I have learned more in the last 2 minutes than 5 years of any intensive study on my part, and I want to thank you again.
Thank you.
Good night.